please. I believe there's those of you that are in here tonight. We shouldn't even wait another moment for anything. It's time tonight. You have a divine appointment with God right now to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. That's what born again means from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. That's how you get in heaven. You don't get in heaven because you think you're good enough to make it. You don't get in heaven because you know a few scripture. You don't get in heaven because, you know, you go to Christmas at a church at Christmas or at Easter. You don't get to heaven because you think you know Jesus. Even the devil thinks he knows Jesus. And he's not going to heaven. Head knowledge won't get you to heaven. And like that song was just saying right now, it is time for you to come. Why wait? And here you are in this safe and friendly place. We've clapped, we've laughed, we've raised our hands, we've did circles and all kinds of stuff and enjoyed moments together. And why not tonight, right now, before we go any further, those of you that are really not right with God, you know who you are. You haven't yet given God all of your heart. You haven't yet given God, come on, be honest with yourself, all of your life. Let's don't go another minute without you getting right with God. And this is your divine appointment. God brought you here tonight so that you could make the decision to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. You've come to the end of your road and you know it. And now it's time to make the commitment that you know you need to do to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. And here we are in this place. Don't miss this opportunity. Jesus makes this statement, and it's an all or nothing statement. You gotta hear it. It's an all or nothing statement with God. All or nothing. He says, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot, or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. What a blunt and even rude statement. I'll vomit you from my mouth. What did Jesus mean by making that statement? He said, people that are lukewarm are not gonna make it, and they're gonna get rejected from Jesus. Lukewarm, little in, little out. Lukewarm, little up, little down. Lukewarm, a token prayer, occasional church attendance. Lukewarm, God is something. He's something, but he's not everything. And tonight, here you are, a divine appointment with God. That's, I didn't even know they were going to sing that song. There's nothing planned about this. We have a wonderful Eddie Algarrick going to come and minister to us in a moment. And he didn't plan on this. I didn't plan on this. But I don't want to miss an opportunity for you to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. You know who you are. You know who you are. You know who you are. And here's how you do it. Listen closely. I want you, as he sings this song again, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff. And you know who you are. Get out of your seat. Get in the aisle. Meet me right here in front. And we'll pray and invite Jesus into our hearts. You don't have to be embarrassed. Guess what? It'd be more embarrassing for you to end up in hell than for you to end up in heaven. So don't let the devil talk you out of it. Just get your stuff and listen. You're not knocking anybody's popcorn over. You can squeeze right by people. Get in the aisle and meet me right here in front right now. This is your time to come. As Reverend sings this again, I want you to examine yourself. Check yourself out. Do you need to come and give God everything, all of your heart and all of your life? He gave you everything, all of his heart and all of his life. Will you come? As the song's being sung, don't hesitate. Don't ask him whether or not your neighbor's going to come. It's not about your neighbor. It's about you personally. Just say, excuse me, I need to go. And you get out of your seat. Man, there's a dozen of you that need to come right now. There's a dozen of you that just need to come. Go ahead and sing that again. You come right now as the song is being sung. They're already coming. Come on.
Broken within. You're overwhelmed by the weight of your sin.
Come on.
Jesus is calling.
Yeah, come on.
It's time you come to the end of yourself.
Come on home.
Do you thirst for a drink from
Nothing embarrassing about it. Just come.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide.
Come on out of the family rooms. You can come. Bring your kids. Come on.
Was bought with the precious blood.
I know I could close this off right now and we've done our job, but I'm fighting for souls right now. Wouldn't America be a different place if pastors fought for souls instead of playing church games, you know? Let me tell you something. I'm fighting for some of your souls right now. Some of you are tossed between yes, doing it and not doing it. And I'm telling you, there's at least 10 more of you. Can you imagine me making a statement like that? 10 more after everybody stopped? There's at least 10 more of you that need to get out of your seat. I don't know if you'll come, but I know this. I know this, that you can feel the presence of God in your heart right now saying to you, He says, you need to go. You need to go. You need to go. And I'm going to have him sing it one more time. And whether you come or don't come, that's your call. I don't want to make you do this, but I want you to know something. This altar's open from the family rooms. You can come, bring your children. Wherever you're at, hurry. Just get in the aisle and get down here right now. If that's you, you're saying to yourself, I should have done that the first time. And you know that's you, then don't miss the second time because you don't want to miss this. Anybody, just come.
Mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait, for Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade.
There's 9 more.
Joy.
There's
from
8
the
more.
Ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Don't come to.
There's 7
the
more.
Altar,
there's 6 more.
The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus.
There's
Christ.
5 more.
Oh,
there's 4 more.
To the altar, the Father's arms are open.
There's 3
wide.
More.
Forgiveness was born with the precious blood
just
of Jesus Christ. Cause Jesus is calling.
Just come. There's 3 more.
Oh, Jesus is calling.
There's 2 more.
Oh, Jesus is
there's
calling.
1 more. 1 more.
Oh, Jesus
is that you?
Calling. Oh, He's calling you tonight. He's calling you tonight.
There's 1 more.
Jesus is calling.
Is that you? There's 1 more. I'm going to give you 1 more moment, and then we're going to stop, and you're going to have missed this. There's just 1 more. Can you imagine that? 1 more. You need to come. You need to come. Just do it. 1 more song, 1 more time.
Come to the altar.
There could be more than
the
one.
The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was falling.
There's 1.
The precious
there's 2.
Blood of
there's 3.
Jesus Christ. Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Isn't God good? You can feel His presence in His house, and you can feel His pleasure in his house. Don't miss that. All of you, thank God you've come. I want you to know that we're going to pray with you. Like I said, this is Pastor Joel right here. Really good guy. No weird, strange stuff goes on. Only takes a few moments. He's going to take you right over there and pray with you. That's all. And then send you right back to your seats. You're going to be washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And listen, wait a minute. Hold on. And I don't care what's in your past. I don't care how many mistakes you ever made. I don't care what the devil has told you. So wait a minute. I don't care what your parents said about you. I don't care what the sergeant in the army told you. I don't care what your school teachers told you. I don't care what your friends rejected you. I don't care anything except you're going to be white as snow, washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight is a great night in the house of God. Hallelujah. I want you to make a left turn. All of you in front, make a left turn. And real quick, follow Pastor Joel right over there. Come on, church. Give him a great big praise.
Oh, thank you very much. Oh, wow. So good to be home. Good to be home. Now you guys can have a seat. I'm a big crybaby, and I'm just so blessed and honored. It's been a long time. I think when we got sent out, we're on our 10th year as the Rock Church, Coachella Valley, and we just had our board of directors meeting not too long ago, and we're making plans. We're going to be starting a program to build our own facility, so we're excited about that. But it's been probably about 8 years since I've been able to preach from the pulpit. Just been busy and just building the church. But I'm excited to be here. And I just want to thank Pastors Jim and Deborah and Pastor Dan and now Pastor Luke and the whole team that is doing just a phenomenal job here at the Rock Church. Thank you very much for allowing me to come in the pulpit. I always consider it an honor to be here. And like Pastor Jim said, we've grown up, my kids have grown up in this church. And we were here really before Pastor Jim started this church up in the mountains, and to see what God has done and being planted and growing and just to see where my kids are and my family. But as Pastor Jim said, my beautiful wife, Pastor Donna, we've been side by side. We're going on 33 years of marriage here. Got married, didn't know what we're going to do, and just decided just to follow Jesus and let Jesus direct us. But I have a picture of my family, and I'm excited about what God is doing in their lives. They're serving God. They love God. And not only that, do we have that picture? Or maybe? Oh, there it is. And so this is our funny picture, because we like to try to be funny. We like to try to do some crazy things. So, I'm just so proud of them. My oldest is on the right, and his wife on the left is our second oldest. And you can tell that he loves Star Wars. And his wife on the left, and then our youngest in the middle. But we also have a beautiful granddaughter. Pastor Eddie's a grandpa. And so there's a picture of her. She's just, actually, she looks like her Nana, just blue eyes and blonde hair, and she's just beautiful, and she's gorgeous, and so that's kind of our family. And like I said, I'm excited to be here. I was just praying, God, what would you have me to share and minister, and just seeing all the familiar faces. Mignon, I remember every Wednesday we'd be working all day getting ready for church. I'd always come up to her, life, say, souls won, healed, delivered, sanctified, set free, right, Mignon? And she'd say, that's right, Pastor Eddie. And just to see the amazing faces of all those that are here. But when I walked in, sometimes I'd have a tough day, a hard day. But then I would see this beautiful face, Felicia. And when I was over there worshiping, I saw her. And I knew that if I was having a tough day, she would say, I'd say, how are you doing, Felicia? She'd say, wonderfully blessed. And just to see her today, you made my day. Love you. Where am I going to go from here? I want you to open up your Bibles in John in the 15th chapter. I'm going to read a couple of verses. We're going to pray and get right into the word today. I told the team when they asked for my notes, I was going to start in verse 18, but I'm going to start in verse 16, and we're going to go through verse 20. Jesus, we're in a series called Live Red, talking about the red letters of Jesus. You know, sometimes it's like, what do I preach? What do I need to say? What do I need? What God, how are you speaking to me? And sometimes I just go to Jesus and see what he says. And he says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit would remain. And that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. But then he goes on in verse 18 and says, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you're of the world would love its own. Yet because you're not of the world, because I've chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, that a servant is not greater than his masters. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. And if they've kept my word, they will keep yours also. Father God, we just come to you today, Lord, and we just thank you. We thank you for words of life that you speak to us. And Father, as we dive into your word today, I just pray, Father God, that I and myself have nothing to say, but Lord, I pray that you would give me the right words to say and speak that might touch and change and build a life up, encourage a life, and maybe challenge them, Lord, to go to new levels, to get to that place where you want them to be. So Father, I just pray that as I open my mouth, use me, Holy Spirit, teach your church, teach your people today as we look and see what you would have for us out of these scriptures. We thank you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Today, what I want to do is I want to share about bringing out the greatness in you. I believe that there's so much greatness on the inside of each and every one of us that sometimes it's buried down on the inside of us and we don't know how to get it out. Maybe we've never had anybody in our lives that have kind of encouraged us to be great, because in our lives we've had lots of people that told us that we weren't great, that we weren't going to amount to anything, that we weren't going to be nothing. And I love what Jesus comes along and he says these words, and he says, I've chosen you. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you that you should go bear fruit. I've appointed you, and I like to look at it this way. Jesus says, I'm choosing you because I want you to show that greatness. I want you to experience that greatness that's on the inside of you. You see, Jesus didn't put us down here. God didn't put us down here on this earth for no reason. He has a purpose, and he has a reason. He wants us to go and bear fruit. He wants us to live a life of greatness. He wants us to live a life of purpose and meaning. And he says, I've called these things, and I want you to bear fruit, and I want to bring out the greatness on the inside of you. I want to for you to live that life of fulfillment. I want you to live that life of purpose and meaning. And then he comes along and he says, love people. And he says, I want you to love one another. But then he goes along and he begins to say some things about the world hating us as believers, as Christians. The world is, he says, if they hated me, they're going to hate you. If they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. And he comes along, and it's kind of one of those things. He's saying, I have greatness on the inside of you. I want you to fulfill greatness in your life. I want you to love people while you're living this life that I've called you to live. But yet on the inside, watch out, because this world is not going to encourage you in your greatness. This world is going to try to pull you down instead of lift you up. Just as they persecuted me, Jesus says, they're going to also persecute you. And I really believe that in order for greatness to really come out of us, and in order for us to fulfill all that God wants us to fulfill, I really believe with all my heart that it's the resistance, it's the pressure in our life that's going to allow us, whether we're going to buckle to the pressure, buckle to the resistance, or say, yes, I'm going to push through, because I know that this resistance, this pressure is going to make me even greater. And Jesus is coming along. He's saying, I want you to be prepared. There's greatness. I want you to bear fruit. I've chosen you. Great things are going to happen. I want to do great things in your life. But yet at the same time, just be aware that there's going to be pressure. There's going to be that resistance. There's going to be those people that may not tell you that there's greatness on the inside of you. But why listen to those people that don't know instead of listening to the God who does know, who created you for greatness? There was a moment in my life. It was a kind of a defining moment when I was 18 years old that I didn't realize it at the time, but I just began to realize it lately. You see, Pastor Jim said, I was a two-time world champion skateboarder, and in 1980, I was entering my second year of becoming a world champion. I was world champion in 1979, and I'd entered a series of competition. It was called the Gold Cup Series of Skateboarding. It was the series. It was like the X Games of the day. And there was five contests, and the overall winner would become the world champion of the day. And coming into the finals of September of 1980, I was in the lead. I was overall winner so far of the four contests. And the fifth contest was going to decide who was the overall winner. And as I came into the contest, the magazines and everybody was saying, oh, you know what, Eddie, all he has to do is show up. As long as he shows up, he's going to win. That's how far ahead he is in the point standings of anyone else. And so competition day came, and all the best skaters in the world were there at the time. And because I was the number one overall winner, I was going to skate last. And the next point leader before me was going to skate right before me, and he was quite a bit of ways in the point standing. So I thought to myself, you know, as long as I just stay on, and you know what, then I'm just going to win. Everybody was saying, all you have to do is just cruise. You're going to make it. It's not going to be no big deal. And so all the skaters go, and then my competitor, his name was Dwayne, and we used to rival each other. They used to call us him. It was kind of good against evil, and so he took his run, and man, it was two runs. And the best out of the two runs was going to advance to the finals. And if I made it to the finals, I would have won overall. I would have been breathing with ease. So he takes his run, and he does great. He smashed it. He killed it. He just did a great run. And I know that the score was just going to be phenomenal for him. And then it was my turn, and I was getting kind of nervous. And so I dropped into the kind of skating that I did is in the empty swimming pools and the big bowls that are out there. And I dropped in, and I began to take my run, and I fell. And then I just got up, and I tried to drop in again and tried to skate again, and I just fell. And I came out, and I was devastated because when I competed, I always wanted to make sure I got one good run first, and then I was going to push it. I only had two runs, and I already fell in the first one, and my competitor that was challenging me for the overall points was already going to take it. If I would have fallen again in my next run, he would have taken it. So I was just like, oh, what am I going to do? I was so nervous, and I came out, and I just had my head down, and, you know, I'd been practicing and striving and for this moment in life, and they began to do all the other runs again, and I was just my head down, and all these guys were coming up to me and say, oh, Eddie, are you nervous, and are you going to fall? Eddie, you know you have to make this run. You see, I'm going to rewind just a little bit. When I came in and when I became a professional skateboarder, I wasn't from the beach. I was living up in Lake Arrowhead. I didn't have the kind of surf style. So I did something that I could do, and I could do tricks. And I started inventing tricks, and I had tricks named after me. And so I did all these things. But these other guys, they didn't like me doing tricks because it was cramp in their style. They couldn't do the tricks, so they didn't want me doing the tricks. So they began to come against me. And when I would go into competition, I would ride up on one side of the wall, and they would yell to try to make me fall. And then I would go up on the other side of the wall, and they would spit on me, and literally spit on me to try to make me fall throughout my career. And so this moment, I'm standing there, and my friend and competitor, he was a friend at one time, he now is a friend again, but he took his run and he did another great run, and it was my turn, and they were all around me, oh, you're going to fall, ooh, we're jinxing you, you're not going to make it. We don't like you. You're going to fall. And it was just one of those things that I thought I was in a dream. And so it was time for me to go and take my run. And I drop in and I begin to carve around the bowl, and I begin to do a trick on this side, and everybody's yelling, fall, fall, and spitting on me. And then I would go onto this side, and they would be yelling and trying to get me fall. And I would go, and I was having a great run. And I remember I was going to do one more trick, and then that was it. And I just said, I have to make this trick. And then I could breathe. And that, you know what? Whether I win the contest or not, I just want to make it into the finals so I could win the overall series. So I went up to the top of the swimming pool, and I threw my board to the side, and I had my foot on the top of the pool. And I was supposed to just jump on and ride out of the bowl and make my run. And so I went up. I was having a good run. I was concentrating, and I threw the board up. I was ready to jump onto the board, and I realized that the board was falling down. It was supposed to stop at the top. And I was all, and it was like, what am I going to do? And it was that pressure of them yelling and them screaming and them just spitting on me. And so if it would have been practice, I would have just threw the board. If it would have been any other time, I would have thrown the board. I think that's just the way it is in life. I think sometimes we get to that place. You know, we go through life, but when the rubber meets the road, what are you going to do? So I threw the board, and I just said, you know, I have to go for it. This is what I'm here for. And I just jumped on the board, praying that I was going to make it. And I landed on the board. And I began to come out of the swimming pool. All the guys that were yelling and wanted me to fall were yelling because they thought I was falling. And then when they saw me rolling up, their eyes were like this big. And I came out of the bowl. Even in the magazines, they had a picture of me in the magazines from that competition. Said Eddie breathing with ease, knowing that he made the finals. But I say that to say this, because when Jesus comes along, he says, I've called you for greatness. I've called you for defining moments in your life. You see, that moment was a defining moment because just a couple weeks ago, I just found out 36 years later that now I'm going to be inducted into the Skateboard Hall of Fame. But I look back at that moment. And I realized that those guys that were taunting me, those guys that wanted me to fall, those guys that didn't want me to do what I was doing, they were like the bully on the playground. They were there trying to tell me what I could do and what I couldn't do. And I just realized that, you know what? You can't tell me how good I'm going to be. You can't tell me how to skate. Just because you don't know how to skate, just because you can't do what I do, doesn't mean that there's not greatness on the inside of me. And I really believe that with us in our lives as believers, that there's a bully in the playground that's trying to tell you what you can do, when you can do, how you can do it, what you can't do. And we know them. And it's not just the bully in the playground, but it's the bully in life. It's the boss. It's the coworker. It's the neighbor in the neighborhood that tries to run the neighborhood and tell you what you can and what you can't do. And there's so much on the inside of you. There's greatness on the inside of you, and it's not coming out. But you know what? I realized because I'm on May 13th, I'm gonna be given my speech as I'm inducted in the Skateboard Hall of Fame. And I told Pastor Don, I said, you know what? I said, if it wasn't for those guys, now you can even see, do we have that picture? I was part of a team called Veriflex. They would call us robots, and they even made a thing saying, it's all about the style. I don't like robot trickery, and I hate the Veribots. And this is a real thing. This is how much they didn't like the way that I was skating. And so I talked to Pastor Donna, and I told her, I said, you know, I really believe that on that day I'm gonna say, if it wasn't for those guys pushing me, if it wasn't for the enemy getting in my face and saying, oh, you think you're gonna do it, And getting back in his face, oh yes, I have greatness on the inside of me. And I really believe that each and every one of us has that greatness. There's a bully that's trying to keep you down. There's somebody in your life that is trying to say you can't do it. God's saying that you can, and you just need to get up. And it's that resistance that helps us to go to that next level. Because if it wasn't for that resistance, if it wasn't for that pressure, if they would have let me alone, I probably wouldn't have done the tricks and pushed myself to do better. So you say, well, Pastor Eddie, what does that have to do with me? And well, in the Bible, throughout the Bible, there's bullies all over the place. I'm going to give you a couple examples, and then we're going to go into something else. But there's so many bullies in the Bible, just like Joseph and his brothers. Joseph had a dream. His father loved him and cared about him, but his brothers didn't like him. The Bible says that the brothers hated him even more when he told them the dream. And they tried to bully him, and they tried to take him out, and they tried to kill him, and they sold him into slavery, and they tried to keep his greatness down on the inside of his life, and they pushed him and pushed him, pushed him, but he rose even to the top. He was able to succeed. It was that jealousy and bullies in our life that the enemy tries to come when he says, you know what, they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. They're going to come in, but it's those bullies that want what you have. And out of that jealousy, that resentment against the success that you may have, the success that you're going forward, you're going to church and God's blessing you and God's doing great things in your life. You know, others aren't going to like it. They're not going to want you to succeed. If they're not succeeding, they definitely don't want you to succeed. If you have a blessed life, they don't want you to have a blessed life. So they will do whatever they can. David and Goliath, it's another bully that comes and wants to lord over you. The Goliath was on the other side, and he said, what's up? He said, I'm going to give you guys an opportunity. If you could beat me, give me your best guy. If you could beat me down, we will serve you. But if not, because this guy was a warrior, he was a champion from his youth. Send me whoever you want. But if we win, we're going to lord over you. See, that's the way it is. People want to come into your life and they want to lord over you. They want to come. They want to intimidate you. They want to control the situation. They want to have power over you. That's one of the things that comes in. And then there's the ones that hate you because you know God, because you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Remember Saul of Tarsus? He was a terrorist. He was a bad man. He was evil, and he was wicked, and he didn't like Christians. And when they came to kill Stephen because he was standing up for his faith, he stood there and giving consent. And when he was saying, I need to go and find all the Christians in Jerusalem, and I want to get them out. He was just a big bully. Like he liked to push his way through, like to bully his way around until God got a hold of him. Ooh. God came and slapped him down. You see, you stand up for God. You live for God. God will take care of the bullies. God will take care of those that are trying to crush the greatness on the inside of you. They're trying to crush that and push it down. And then there was Jesus. He didn't do anything wrong. He didn't hurt anyone. All he did was help and heal and open the blind eyes and touch the leper and cleanse them. But the Pharisees didn't like him. The Pharisees tried to bully him around and, no, we don't like you. We don't like this. And when he came around to Pontius Pilate, he says, there's a prisoner that I can release. Which prisoner do you want me to release? And the Bible says this. Could you put that verse up in Matthew 27, verse 18? It says that they, out of envy. You see, envy comes along and envy tries to pull you down. Do we have that verse? Envy is people that are threatened by your position. The Pharisees were threatened by his position. You see, there's bullies everywhere. You know what? You may have been a bully. You may have been the one that tries to manipulate. You may be the one that tries to hold people down, but there's a new day. God wants you to be not the bully, but he wants you to be the victor. He wants you to understand that there's greatness on the inside of you. He wants you to understand that he wants to do something great on the inside of your life. And so how do we handle this? Jesus says, I have greatness. I've chosen you. I've appointed you. There's some great things that I want for you in your life. And I love how he adds in between, love one another, because then he says about the world hating you and the world persecuting you, the world coming against you. But how did Jesus handle the bullies? What did he give us? What was some of the insight that he helped us to understand, to release that greatness on the inside of us? I want you to turn to Matthew in the 5th chapter. Are you guys there with me? Matthew in the 5th chapter. Dealing with those bullies. You know, I remember even Pastor Richard Michelle, they knew, because I used to still compete as a youth pastor in the master's division. And they saw firsthand how people didn't like me, but even back then, they would come against me. They would try to make me fall. And it's like, come on, guys, we're grown men. Yeah, we may have little shorts on and pads and helmets, but we're grown men. And as I'm in my 40s and still doing this, and now I'm still in my 50s. Now I'm 50, going to be 54 this year, right? 54, and I still am able to compete in the Legends divisions. But in Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse 38, it says, Jesus says, you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's the way that we're trained and as our human nature. You mess with me, I'm going to mess with you. You spit on me, I'm going to spit on you. You know what? You try to make me fall, I'm going to try to make you fall. You try to mess with my family, I'm going to mess with your family. And Jesus says, you heard it said that way. And that's what we've heard, and that's what we want to believe. But he says, but I tell you not to resist an evil person. But whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek to him also. What? Jesus, say what? What? He's saying, you know what? If they slap you on one cheek, turn the other cheek. And the first thing that I want to take a look at this, and Jesus says here, he says, you know, I really don't want you to retaliate. I don't want you to take the matters into your own hand, because if you take the matters into your own hand, you're going to get in trouble. He says, just turn the other cheek. Just walk away. Don't worry about them. And I really believe, because I wasn't a Christian at the time when I was a world champion skateboarder when that competition happened, but I believe that that's what I was doing. I didn't want to retaliate. It says, what good is going to come out of it? I was just standing there and just, I probably was praying, and I didn't know who I was praying to, but I was praying to God. I was saying, just God, I just help me to stay on my board. God, I just, you know, I'm trying to block out these voices that are trying to pull me down. I know you called me to greatness. And you say, well, what is so the greatness is of skateboarding? That's, you know, you should be preaching the gospel. You should be doing some other things. You see, by me being inducted in the Skateboard Hall of Fame, it opens up a whole other door, a whole other avenue of me being able to preach the gospel around the world. I think there's only 20 other skateboarders that are in the Skateboard Hall of Fame. Out of everyone in the world, there's only about another 20 people that are inducted in the Skateboard Hall of Fame. And yet, it has opened that door. Whatever happened 36 years ago, all that time, see, what you're doing today is preparing you for the greatness, what God has for you down the road. But if you retaliate, all of a sudden, it takes you back to the beginning. And you go forward, and you're going on, and then you retaliate because you want to go in the flesh. Jesus says, you know what, just turn the other cheek. And Jesus comes and he says, I don't want you to retaliate. Just turn. Whoever slaps you, just turn the other cheek. And then he says these words. If anyone wants to sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak also. In other words, what Jesus is saying, you know what? Just do more. Do more than what's required. You know, if somebody is asking for you something, just go over and above and just help them that even that much more. You see, this last year in 2015, I put an event on, a skateboard event for all the legends in the sport of skateboarding. And I invited them all, even the guys that were spitting on me, yes, even the guys that didn't want me to succeed. And I invited all these legends together, and I hosted an event, and Tony Hawk came out, and all these other skateboarders and that maybe you do or do not know, but everybody knows who Tony Hawk is. And so I invited them out, and I paid for a dinner for them. Some of them, we got them rooms. The city of Palm Springs invested in helping put this on. And it was amazing because I went over, but I could have just said, you know what? It's old. It's in the past. We're older now. Let's just get on with it. Let's get on with life. But I wanted to bring them all together, and I brought them together, and one of the guys came up to me in private, and he says, you know what, Eddie? At first, when you put this event on, because you called it the Elgato Classic, because that was my nickname, is El Gato. And so he says, when he first put on this event, I was kind of skeptical. He says, it's all about Eddie. He just wants his name on anything. And he's just trying to get us out. He's trying to manipulate us or whatever. He says, but when you called me in, I realized that it wasn't that way. And these words came out of his mouth. He said, I'm sorry for all the crap that I did to you when we were skating. I apologize. And it wasn't because I was so great. It was because you can't lose when you give. You can't lose when you go over and above. And Jesus says, you know what? If they want to take your cloak, give them your tunic also. Just like in Genesis, in the 50th chapter, we see Joseph at the end of his life. After he came in charge and everything was going his way. He's fulfilling his dream. What did Joseph do when he found out that his brothers wanted food? He didn't say, forget you guys. Or, yeah, you know what, you guys could come, but you could live off to the side. He says in Genesis in the 50th chapter, verse 18, he says, then his brothers also came down and fell at his face. They were scared. They were worried because they had sold him. They tried to kill him first, and then they sold him into slavery. And then he was thrown into prison. You know, how many times he could have been rehearsing over his head, when I see my brothers again, oh, they're going to get it. You think they're going to get something out of me? They're not going to get something out of me. They're going to get a big fat lip. That's what most of us would have been thinking. And that's what his brother said, oh, man, oh, here we are. Fell down his face, and behold, we are your servants. And Joseph says, do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring it about this day to save many lives. And he says, now, therefore, because I just told you that God used this for good, don't be afraid. He says, I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. You see, he went over and above. He did more than was required. He could have just said, you know what? All right, guys, yeah, you did me wrong. I'll put a little place over off to the side. He says, no, I'm going to take care of you and your kids. I'm speaking kindly about you. You didn't know what you were doing. You were just the big bully that was trying to hold that greatness down on the inside of me. But I'm here to tell you that greatness that was on the inside of me, you couldn't hold it down. The devil couldn't hold it down. Potiphar couldn't hold it down. The jail couldn't hold it down. That greatness was eventually going to come out. And so I don't hold you accountable for that. And I'm going to go and do over and above. And Jesus comes and says, let him have your tunic also. But then, verse 41 says, Jesus says, and whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him an extra. He just says, you know what? Be generous. Yeah, do more than what's required, but he said, be generous. If somebody comes and says, all you have to do is this, go over and above. You know, as we are taught in the church to tithe, you know, we know that God says in his word about bringing the first of our increase. And see, a lot of people legalistically will go, okay, I'm going to come, I'm going to count it down to the penny. I'm going to round it. Maybe if I have to round, I'm going to round down instead of round it up. We'll do what we can to try to figure out. And God says, go over and above. If somebody tells you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. I'd rather go above than below. I'd rather go higher than go lower. And Jesus is saying, if somebody comes to you, and that bully tries to put you down and push you down, and you know what? Just go the extra mile. In Luke, in the 15th chapter, when the prodigal son realizes it, comes to his senses. The prodigal son wanted his inheritance from his dad. Dad, let me have my inheritance. Let me go live the life. And he lived it with prostitutes and partying and squandered it all. And then he finds himself sleeping with the pigs and eating with the pigs. He says, if only I was at my father's house. If I was just a servant, I would, you know, it would be okay if I was just a servant. Even my father's servants eat better than I do. Let me go back and ask for forgiveness. And I'm going to ask for forgiveness, and hopefully he'll make me his servant. And in Luke, in the 15th chapter, if we have that. And his son said to him, says, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, he didn't say, just let's get him into the house. He says, my son, yeah, he screwed me over. Yeah, he treated me bad. Probably talked about the family. Probably was telling everybody how I didn't want to give him the inheritance, but I gave it to him anyways. But his father said to the servants, bring out the best robe. Put it on him and put a ring on his hand and his sandals on his feet. And he says, and bring out the fatted calf. Just bring out the best calf that we have. Let's spare no expense. And kill it. Let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost. Now he's found. And they began to be merry. You know, today there's some of you in this place, people have told you, you can't do anything. You've had a dream in your heart, and you've put it aside. You've always felt like people have manipulated you or intimidated you and made you feel like that you couldn't do anything in life. You felt the pressure, but when the pressure came, you backed off. You know, I heard this story about a little boy who was walking down the road and he found this little cocoon, and it was an emperor moth cocoon, and he picked it up because it was moving. And he took it home and he put it on the table and he began to look at it and he began to see the shadow of this emperor moth that was going to come out, and it was going to be beautiful, and it was going to be beautiful wings, and it was going to expand and just be amazing. And it was waiting for it to happen. He's waiting for the miracle to take place. And as he saw it chipping away, he saw it chip a little bit of hole, and he began to see a little bit of the emperor moth coming out of it. And then he saw a little bit more. And then he saw this emperor moth trying to squeeze through a little hole. But out of the goodness of his heart, he says, I can't see this. And he takes a little clippers, and he began to clip a little hole to make it easier for that emperor moth to pop out. So he just snipped just a little bit. And the emperor moth had popped out. But it wasn't what he thought it was. It was deformed, and it was bloated, and it did not look beautiful like he knew and what it should have looked like. You see, what he didn't realize is that the emperor moth needed the pressure to push the liquid through its body. And sometimes we want everybody to do everything for us. We want the easy way. We don't want the pressure. We don't want to have a hard time. We want everything given and handed to us. But in all reality, God says, there's going to be some pressure. And you're going to need that pressure in order for you to be great. In order for you to look beautiful. In order for you to look amazing. And that emperor moth, because it didn't have that pressure to expand the liquid in its body, out of the goodness of the heart of the little boy, he suffered. You see, that's the way it is with us. Jesus says, I've called you to greatness. I've chosen you before you chose me. I've appointed you. I want you to bear fruit. I want you to love people. But understand, there's going to be pressure. There's going to be people that don't like you. There's going to be people that come against you. But in the midst of that pressure, know that God is preparing you for greatness. God is preparing you for something great. We're going to end here in a moment, but may I have just a couple more minutes? If all of you could stand to your feet. If you have felt in this place that you know that there's greatness on the inside of you, but there's maybe it's situations, maybe it's people, maybe it's the life that you live that has held you back from becoming great. I want you just to come, and we don't have lots of time. I just want you to come to this altar because I want to pray over you. And I just want to pray that you would release those people, that you would release those bullies, that you would allow God to come on the inside of you, that the pressure that you have, that you would realize that yes, I'm going to go through this pressure because I know that if I go through this pressure, God's going to do something great. God, don't take away this pressure because I need it in my life so it could get me to the next level, because 10, 20, 30 years from now, that pressure that you put on the inside of me is now going to come out and I'm going to use it for your glory. Come. Don't wait. Just hurry up. Come to this altar. You were called for greatness. Don't allow and don't let anybody tell you that you weren't. Don't allow anybody to say that you're nothing. That when you were born that you were a mistake. You're not a mistake. God does not make junk. God's created you for a reason, for a purpose. He wants you to do great things in your life. Come on up. Hurry up. Hurry. Just come and say yes. Yes, God. Because you are called for greatness. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. God wants you to know that when you were a child, whatever happened that caused you to run and doubt, he said that was just some pressure. That he wants you to know that all things work for good. That even though you did run, he's saying you're here now. He's here. You're here now. There might be pressure going on in your life, but it's going to be a good pressure. God wants to do some great things. You just allow Him. Allow Him just to move. Father God, I just thank you for each and every person that is here, Lord. Father, they've walked up to this altar. And Lord, just as in my life, when people tried to push me down and try to say I couldn't make it, there was times I wanted to give up. And many of these people, they feel like there's greatness on the inside of them, but they've been squished and pushed down, and it's like their dreams have been lost and forgotten. But Lord, I pray that you would revive those dreams back in their lives, that they would realize that they are valued, that you've called them for greatness, you've called them to do great things for the kingdom of God, that no weapon formed against them is going to prosper, Lord. Father, all those things that were meant for evil in their life, all those bullies that told them that they weren't going to amount to anything, our Lord, shall come to shame, and they're going to go and do great things for you. Father, I thank you, Lord, that as they leave this place, they're going to leave knowing that you have a purpose for their life, that they're going to be great fathers, they're going to be great husbands. They're going to be great preachers. They're going to love people to life. They're going to do whatever they can, Lord, to honor you with their life, because you've chosen them for great. You've chosen them, Lord, to do great things in the kingdom. Father, I pray for healing right now in their bodies, that spiritual healing, Lord. I pray that you would begin to revive them, that you would begin to speak to them, that you would begin to breathe life into them right now, Lord. We thank you, Father God. You are so good. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this place. Thank you, Lord, for allowing me to come and speak your word. And I pray, Lord, that they would begin to listen to your voice and not the voice that would try to pull them down. We thank you, Lord. You're so good. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Wow, wasn't that fabulous?